Hello everybody, welcome back to the Cloud Interview Catalyst series. This is interview question 5 of this series. Okay, this is actually an interview question that I had faced in one of the interviews that I was giving. That is why I put this down here. So the question is more related to Kubernetes. So in case you are not aware of Kubernetes till now, then it's okay, you might want to skip this one. But very frankly, from a cloud architecture perspective, it is considered that a cloud architect will know most of this stuff by default, because you can actually consider that cloud native architectures is kind of synonymous with Kubernetes nowadays. And it's very important for any cloud architect, any aspiring cloud architect or a potential cloud architect, to know about Kubernetes, and at least the high level to start with, from a decision making and architectural perspective, and also a little bit to the depth, because I have had interviews where there was a separate session, interview session just on Kubernetes. Okay, so say the question is, as a cloud architect, you are made in charge of the foundational architecture of all Kubernetes deployments in your company. There are multiple service lines that will deploy their apps on top of Kubernetes, and you need to decide what should be the approach: a single cluster to deploy all the applications, or multiple small clusters per application. What are some of the considerations that you need to factor in while making such an enterprise-wide decision or guideline? So basically, see, just like an enterprise architecture team gives guidelines and best practices, say for example an enterprise architecture practice, EA practice in a company might say that go on, you need to use GitHub for all your source control, or Azure repos for all your source control, because these are the benefits, these are the limitations. And this is a company-wide practice. So an enterprise architecture team mostly, or a center of excellence teams mostly, tries to focus on components that will impact the entire organization. So in this case, as a EA architect, or for example as a cloud architect or a Kubernetes architect, you have to decide, okay, you have to put some sort of a policy in place organization-wide, or say for a business unit-wide, that all applications which will be deployed on top of Kubernetes, will they be deployed on top of a single big cluster, one big Kubernetes cluster, or for every single application will you create small clusters? Okay, or is there any other thing that you need to do? Okay, now the idea here, okay, what the question wants to understand, the interviewer wants to understand is, what are your thoughts about implementing multi-tenancy in a Kubernetes environment or a Kubernetes ecosystem? There is no correct answer that, okay, this is it. Just like a lot of answers in architecture, this is also a lot of nuances that you need to discuss with your interviewer, and then try to come to some sort of a logical conclusion where you might choose something, but at the same time we'll list down all the limitations and all the trade-offs and all the decisions that help to achieve that stage or conclusion. So in this case, if you see all of these articles that I have mentioned, okay, so I will open an article that will help you understand this. So basically, see, there can largely be, okay, four different kind of situations. So you can either have a few very large clusters, this can be one type of design, or you can have many small clusters. Okay, so many small clusters meaning small clusters, but a lot of them in your environment. So say for example, if you have one cluster per application unit, then it could even be thousands of clusters. And at the same time, a few large clusters might be 2 to 3 very big large clusters where all your applications are deployed. Now within that, what are the four stages? As you can see, one large shared cluster. So one cluster hosting everything. Another is one cluster per environment, meaning you have one cluster for dev, one cluster for QA, one cluster for prod. Another is one cluster per application, meaning every single application has its own cluster. Okay, meaning one, say you have an application called shopping cart, okay, that is a microservice in itself. So one shopping cart deployment unit in dev will be one application. Okay, something like that. Or say for example, one shopping cart application, all dev, QA, prod in one cluster. So one cluster contains one application, but all the different environments or the applications, so dev, QA, prod. And small single use clusters, like I mentioned, every single unit has one deployment. So now let us explain something. See, say you have three applications, application 1, application 2 and application 3. Same time you have three environments, dev, test and prod. Okay, just a very simplistic view we are taking here, but this also results in 9 application instances or units. So this is something you have to actually deploy. So you can see each application instance is a self-contained deployment unit that can be operated and independently operated from the others. So here, when I talk about one application unit, this unit itself might be broken down into multiple microservices within it. So you can see an application instance may consist of multiple components in a microservices world. I'm not thinking that it's a monolith. There might be multiple services, front-end service, back-end service, database. In a microservice application, an application instance would in turn consist of other microservices. Okay. But for a simplistic perspective, this yellow box contains, say, one microservice application, which in turn has some small microservice. But from our deployment perspective, this is one deployable unit of my application. Okay. So you have 9. So now, what is the option 1 that we decided? We deployed everything on a single cluster. Okay. So all of my applications are deployed, dev, test, prod, dev, test, prod, dev, test, prod, everything deployed on a single big cluster. So what are the advantages? What are the disadvantages we need to consider? This is option 1. Then what is option 2? Option 2 is basically many small single clusters. So these are the two different ends of the spectrum. So you can see app 1 dev, one cluster. App 1 test, another cluster. So I have 9 clusters for those 9 deployable instances. So one was the most extreme, one cluster for everything, and this is one cluster for every single deployable unit, meaning 9 clusters for those 3 applications, 3 environments, 3 into 3, 9 clusters, as you can see. But in between, if you have to take in between, you can have one cluster per application. This is another approach. So here one application has one cluster, but dev, test and prod, all of them will go into one cluster. And there is another app, dev, test and prod, all of them will go into one cluster. Okay, so 3 applications, only 3 clusters, because dev, test and prod, they all exist in the same cluster. Okay, then what is the last one? One cluster per environment. So dev has, so again 3 environments, 3 clusters, all dev workloads posted one, all test posted in another, all prod pushed to a prod cluster. So what are the trade-offs? And how should you approach, which is a better option, which is something that you need? So this is very important to understand these options and the trade-offs, because no approach is made in concrete or written in stone, so to speak. Okay. So what you first need to understand at a high level, okay, is that what are the advantages of having everything in a single cluster? So one of the advantages that is it's very easy to manage and it's a little bit less costly. Okay, because if you need to have 9 clusters, okay, from a management perspective, it's a huge overhead. And at the same time, many of your resources might be underutilized. And if you have a separate master node, okay, if you have to create separate master node for every single cluster, even if I consider one node for one cluster, then for a big, small ones, you have 9 extra master nodes for every single 9 cluster. But for a big one, you have only one master node. Say for example, you can even have more than one master node. But the idea here is, okay, so as you can see this approach, what is the good thing? Efficient resource usage. As I told you, you are much more efficiently, you can, so as you can see, the master nodes, If you have only a single cluster, you might need only 3 master nodes, considering that a typical Kubernetes cluster has 3 master nodes. But if you had 10 Kubernetes clusters and each Kubernetes cluster had 3 master nodes, then you would actually need 30 master nodes, right? Again, there are some cluster-wide services like logging, Fluentd, authentication, ingress controllers. If you create different clusters for different applications, then you have to install this cluster-wide applications or services in every single cluster, which will again consume space. But if I have a single Kubernetes cluster, I can just install Kubernetes, say an Nginx ingress controller at one place and then use different routes for the different applications. So it's a possibility. I can do that if I want. So those cluster-wide services. So if you have only a single cluster, you can reuse those services for all your workloads. You don't need to have multiple copies for them. Again, it's cheap, as I discussed. And efficient administration. So there you see, the less number of things you need to manage, the easier it is for you, very frankly. So administering a single cluster is easier than administering many clusters. It can be any task like upgrading the Kubernetes version. If I have 100 clusters, I will have to upgrade each of those clusters going in. But if I have one cluster, I just upgrade one cluster. Setting up a CI/CD pipeline to deploy into that cluster. Installing a new CNI plugin, maybe Calico. Setting up a user authentication system. Installing a new admission controller. So if you have a single cluster, you need to do all of this only once. But if you have multiple clusters, you need to apply everything multiple times. And at that point of time, obviously, you will have to set up or invest your time, effort, energy, money into some sort of an automation tool chain that does that for you, or rely on some third party company, like say, for example, VMware Tanzu, to do those stuff for you. Okay, something you have to rely on to manage that for you, because it is adding a lot of overhead for you. Okay, if you have multiple clusters, now what are the cons? Single point of failure. If your cluster is down, everything goes down. So, and since you have dev and prod workloads in the same cluster, even if somebody is changing something, say somebody trying to upgrade something for a dev, and the entire production goes down. So a Kubernetes upgrade produces unexpected side effect. Any cluster-wide component such as a CNI plugin is not working as expected. An erroneous configuration is made to one of the cluster components. An outage occurs in the underlying infrastructure, which is on top of which the Kubernetes layer is built. Whatever happens, single incident like this can cause major damage across all your workloads because there is no isolation. There is a single point of failure. You have not factored in for any redundancy. So the same concepts of architecture applies here. Also, no hard security isolation. This is very important. So there is no true multi-tenancy as such. Okay, obviously you can say, can I implement namespaces within this Kubernetes, but again, namespace is a soft kind of multi-tenancy. Okay, it's not a hard multi-tenancy, and this is explained a lot in detail here. Okay, so as you can see here, it's effectively a Kube namespace is a soft multi-tenancy model. There are multiple cluster components that are shared across all tenants within a cluster, regardless of a namespace. These shared components include the API server, controller. Sharing these non-namespace aware components between tenants necessarily exposes tenant resources to all other tenants in the cluster on the same worker node. That's why it's called soft multi-tenancy, not true isolation. For example, tenant 1 can see the services that tenant 2 has published into the shared cluster DNS. So at the end of that, it is still running on the same VM. It will not provide you the kind of isolation that a virtual machine provides. Never. At the end of the day, these are just processes running on the OS. Obviously, you can do some very clever RBAC, very clever resource policies to protect your applications. You can put network policies in place. But at the end of the day, they are very hard to configure and get right. Okay. So there is no hard security isolation. So as you can see, Linux containers do provide some form of isolation, but this isolation is not as strong as the one provided by, for example, virtual machines. Under the hood, the process in a container is just still a process which is running on the host's operating system. Okay, so this could be a security issue. Okay, so somebody might say, "Why I don't want my workload to be hosted with somebody else's workload. I don't know what he is doing, what kind of policies they have put in place. I don't want that." So there is no real multi-tenancy. So as you can say, no hard multi-tenancy. So there are many ways that different apps can step on each other's toes. Obviously, there are various ways to control this behavior, but again, it's not trivial to tweak these tools in exactly the right way. And they cannot prevent every unwanted side effect. Also, many users and clusters cannot grow infinitely large. So at one point of time, you need to understand that I cannot just keep on adding nodes to my cluster. Somewhere there is a limit that Kubernetes has. Say, for example, one of the old limits was 5,000 nodes, 150,000 pods and 300,000 containers. What happens if your cluster reaches this size? Then again, you have to go for another cluster. That's same, right? And also many users. If you have a single cluster, then many people in your organization must have access to this cluster. So this is one of the most extreme, okay? Which is one cluster, which obviously makes sense sometimes, but again, it might not make sense for your specific use case. Now coming to the next part, which is many small single use clusters. Okay, again, this is another part of the horizon. So here, reduce blast radius, obviously. You have good isolation, very good. Few users, because only the ones who need to access this app, you will give only them access. And if this breaks down, you still have the other application units running, so no problem. But what is the cons? The best, most important con is it is inefficient resource usage and it is expensive. For example, you might have to run 30 master nodes instead of 3 for the same compute power. Okay, and obviously you can see that every single cluster will require a set of management resource, master nodes, control plane, component, monitoring, logging solutions, everything it will need. Okay, because every single application unit is a separate cluster. So all the cluster wide resources like ingress controls, everything you have to deploy there again separately, and it's complex. If you even want to upgrade the Kubernetes version, you need to do it 9 times in this case. Every simple change, any simple change has to be replicated across every single cluster. Okay, so you need to develop some automated process to do this. Then comes cluster per application and then comes cluster per environment. So you can go over this. But see, the idea is to understand all of the approaches. Now I will tell you what I follow. Okay, and what I have advised some of my clients to do and what we used to follow in my old company also is a cluster per environment. So I have one cluster for my dev, one cluster for my prod. So here I know that there will be an increase in cost, but I'm okay with that. That is the trade-off I am making. I want my prod workloads to be not impacted by anything bad that happens in dev. At least my prod workloads, I am giving that separate situation. Okay. I am telling them, okay, for a prod workload, if you have a prod workload, then you host it in a separate cluster. So at least the prod owner will have some sort of an assurance that something bad, even if it happens in dev, whether it is his application, somebody else's application, you have something, some sort of a redundancy. Okay. Or another thing is that if I have to upgrade the Kubernetes version or make some changes or something, I can first do it in dev, I test it and then go to prod. So this is another benefit. Okay. Then what I do, okay, what I advise is that within the prod or the dev, whatever, different applications, for those applications which do not have a strict requirement on multi-tenancy or strong isolation requirements they don't have, and also they don't have a lot of money, meaning they don't have a lot of budget, then I will host them within the single cluster, small application within a single cluster, and isolate based on namespaces. Using namespaces, I will isolate them. But say there is a very big application and they have the money to pay for a separate cluster, then I will create another cluster for them. That is the idea. So small applications which can stay together, okay, which do not have such strong requirements, then, and they don't have a lot of money, then you host them within a single. So, but still dev and prod cannot mix. No matter how much money you don't have, if you want to use, then you have to deploy dev in dev and non-prod in non-prod and prod in prod. So that is something, that is a kind of rule you enforce. Nobody in your organization can deploy a dev workload in a prod. No. If you are deploying in prod, it's prod. That cluster might have a different SLA than a normal the dev cluster. The dev cluster, if it's down, it's still okay. But a prod cluster, if it is down, it should be a P1 or a P2, for example. So all of these approaches you need to consider. And then if somebody has a really good use case, really strong use case for isolation, and they have the budget, then we create another cluster for them. So this is how we can think of applying this kind of a policy for. But again, there is no correct answer that, okay, do this, do that. What you need to understand are all of the trade-offs. So for example, in this cluster per environment approach that I was telling, okay, so you have at least an isolation of the prod environment. So you can say the production version of my app is now not affected by whatever happens in any of the other clusters and application environments. Also, your cluster can be customized for an environment. So for example, your development and debugging tools can stay in the dev cluster. You can use more powerful hardware for the prod cluster. So the prod cluster obviously will have a more powerful hardware. You can lock down access to the prod cluster, because not everybody who has access to the dev cluster will need access to the prod cluster. Maybe only your prod operation team. Not everybody can deploy directly to the prod cluster. The developers might not get access. They might have to go through a CI/CD toolchain, maybe via Argo CD or Flux, or something like that, or maybe just give their deployment files to the deployment team or the production cluster operations team to get that thing done. It can be anything basically. But obviously there is a little bit lack of isolation. In case you need strong isolation, then obviously you can create another cluster, just like I was saying. But obviously the main disadvantage of this approach is the missing hardware and resource isolation between apps, and the app requirements are not localized also. So as you can see, then this link I have already shared, this is a very good link. Again, the similar kind of an approach is also mentioned in this blog. Okay, this blog is obviously a vendor affiliated blog. So basically this is trying to list all of the issues. But see, from my perspective, if you ask me, that yes, multi-cluster is important. You need to get that architecture right, because somewhere down or the other you will have multiple clusters in your environment, because just the limits that a single cluster imposes will, if not anything else, just the limits that a single cluster imposes on you by default, Kubernetes imposes on you, will force you. If you are too big, you will have to go to that multiple cluster thing. But how to do that, the tooling that can support you, that is very important. Whenever you have multiple clusters, think, okay, even if I'm doing this change, how can I replicate it across all clusters? What processes can I follow? There should be some sort of a process. Say, for example, if I will first do this in a dev cluster, then in a QA cluster, then in a prod cluster. And the prod cluster, obviously the namespace policies in a multi-tenant cluster, there needs to be very properly implemented. You need to have good security so that nobody can hack your etcd. Nobody can basically exploit your cluster and start running some cron job or something which takes a lot of space and impacts other applications. No. Similar approach that you have to any sort of a multi-tenancy or any sort of a SaaS multi-tenant design also applies here. So the perspective that I wanted to have for this question from you is to understand these concepts, because this will not be a single question, okay? Just like I am saying, this question will not be like a single question and the answer will come in another 5 minutes. No, this will be a discussion based question. If I ask this question to somebody, a potential candidate I want to hire, then I will be looking for these points, like what is his thinking? Does he know this? Can he do these trade-offs? Does he understand the limitations of the different architectures? Not just for Kubernetes, but for any normal kind of reference multi-tenant design. Does he think like an architect in this perspective? Is he reading some good material on this? Is he aware that this is actually a problem? And there is a problem that can come in any enterprise. So an architect should read up on this kind of problems that can potentially come up in an enterprise. Anyways, so thank you guys for listening to this. And as you can see, the references are shared here. You can go through them in your time and understand this in more detail. Please ping me in case of any questions that you have. and I will be happy to help. And just like every other question, try to understand the nuances of the design rather than trying to go for a strict black and white answer, because most of these answers will be gray. And this is where cloud architecture comes into place. It is more about trade-offs, quality attributes, and a lot of things. The best architecture will be extremely expensive, and many clients will not be able to pay for it. So you will have to go to the next best architecture. So you need to have those trade-offs listed. Whenever you choose this, you have a document created. Okay, these are the decisions that led to this. These are the trade-offs, these are the risks, and this is accepted by the customer at that point of time. Thank you, everybody. Take care and have a nice day.